Good evening and welcome to this evening's lecture. My name is Ian Henderson. I'm the interim dean of the Faculty of Religious Studies. I'm also a member of the Bible area, and so it's a particular pleasure tonight to be welcoming you to this Birks lecture. The Birks lectures in the Faculty of Religious Studies have a distinguished history. They were founded in 1950 as the gift of the Birks family, and it's a joy for us that members of the Birks family are here with us this evening, as so often. And we're grateful for that long-standing friendship. That's a joy to us. The Birks lectures have included scholars from around the world, among them Houston Smith, Northrop Frye, our own Wilfred Cantwell Smith, Gregory Baum, Christer Stendahl, Charles Adams, John Levinson, David Little, Azim Nanji, Paul Griffiths, Bernadette Bruton, Harvey Cox, John Hawley, Gabriel Vahanian, Oliver O'Donovan, and Jan Osman. And so it's a joy for us each year to welcome a distinguished scholar who has made an outstanding contribution in this field. And so tonight we have, as our special guest, John Collins, and I'll be asking my colleague, Professor Gabriel Ugama, to introduce him.
Yes, Professor John Collins, most welcome to this Heritage Chapel of the Birks building. Professor Collins is a native of Ireland, and I think that is something to be proud of, and especially also in the city of Montreal, where we have many Irish people. He studied at Harvard, did his PhD, 72, I believe, and published in 74 his dissertation on the Sibylline Oracles. He was a professor at the Paul in Chicago and at the University of Notre Dame in Indiana. He was in the 1990s professor of Hebrew Bible at the University of Chicago, and since 2000 at Yale University, Divinity School. And everything with his wife, Adelia Iowa Collins, who can't be here today because she has a lecture, I believe, somewhere else. But now we see them together, and it's always a pleasure. Everywhere in the world, it's conferences to meet them. 1974, his first publication, he has a whole list of books, more than 20. But if you look at the early Judaism, his field, in addition to Hebrew Bible, in the early 1970s, it hardly existed. Yes, and then if you then look at his publication since then, he was one of the founders, actually, of the field of early Judaism. And he covers everything from Hellenistic Judaism to apocalypticism, from Qumran to wisdom literature, and he has an encyclopedic knowledge, and of course he's also the editor of Encyclopedia about apocalypticism and introductions to the Hebrew Bible and the early Judaism. So he has an enormous knowledge of the field, which he has created with a number of other scholars to this important field. Today he's going to give a lecture with the a fascinating title, Torah and Jewish Identity in Second Temple Judaism. And we will be sure to hear all the various aspects of that topic. And tomorrow, same time, same place, a second lecture, Non-Mosaic Forms of Judaism in the Second Temple Period. Yeah? And I just had my graduate seminar yesterday, and we discussed the Essenes. I showed the students your latest book about the Essenes. And one of the elements we read was they would wake up early, like you today, prior to sunrise. So, welcome.
Thank you very much. Thank you both. It's a great pleasure for me to speak here in Montreal. When I was a graduate student at Harvard a little over 40 years ago, I had an uncle living here in Montreal who was still alive at the time, and so I spent three Christmases in Montreal. And my first memory of Montreal was shoveling out from 24 inches of snow. Now, at least it's only raining today. There is one note of sadness on this occasion. The person who wrote to me to invite me to give these lectures was Ellen Aitken, and I was very much looking forward to seeing her here. I had gotten to know her when she was at Harvard. She had spoken at Yale in the 90s, and she was a lovely person. And then suddenly I heard that she was on medical leave, and before I had time to react to that, I heard that she had passed away. And she's a great loss to us all, and I'm very sad that she isn't here tonight. So now to Jews, Judeans, and the Maccabean crisis. In the reign of the Syrian king Antiochus Epiphanes, the inhabitants of Judea faced a crisis that would have far-reaching implications. Epiphanes had invaded Egypt for a second time, and unlike the first time, this invasion had not gone well. He had been forced to withdraw from Egypt in humiliating circumstances by the Roman legate Papilius Lenas. A rumor spread in Judea that he had died in Egypt, and Jason the Oneid, who had briefly held the high priesthood but had been supplanted by Menelaus, seized the occasion to try to regain power. Civil war broke out in Jerusalem. This now was a slight dispute about the exact date, but either 168 or 167 BCE. And civil war broke out in Jerusalem. According to 2 Maccabees, when news of what had happened heard the king, he took it to mean that Judea was in revolt. He proceeded to sack Jerusalem and pillage the temple. But this was not all. And I'm quoting now from 2 Maccabees. Not long after this, the king sent an Athenian elder to compel the Judaioi to depart from their ancestral laws and to pollute the temple in Jerusalem and name it for Zeus Olympios. The temple on Mount Gerizim, that is the temple of the Samaritans, was to be named for Zeus Xenios, as those who inhabited that place requested. It was impossible either to keep the Sabbath, to observe the ancestral festivals, or openly confess oneself to be a Judaios. The question I would like to pursue here is, what exactly one could not confess oneself to be? What did it mean to be a Judaios in the 2nd century BCE? Was this a matter of consensus, or was it contested? And how did the understanding of Judean identity change in the course of the Second Temple period? For some time now, a debate has raged as to whether Judaios should be translated as Jew or as Judean. Shia Cohen, professor at Harvard, distinguished three basic meanings of the term. A Judaios may be a Judean, that is a function of birth and or geography, or a Jew, a function of religion and culture, or a citizen or ally of the Judean state, a function of politics. The first and third of these senses are relatively uncontroversial. The main question at issue is whether and when we can speak of Jews who were Judaioi by religion and culture as distinct from being ethnically or politically Judean. For Cohen, a Judaios in the religious sense is someone who believes, or is supposed to believe, certain distinctive tenets, and or follows, or is supposed to follow, certain distinctive practices. In other words, a Judaios is someone who worships the God whose temple is in Jerusalem and who follows the way of life of the Jews. Cohen argues that this sense of the word Judaios first appears in the 2nd century BCE, and indeed that it is first exemplified in 2 Maccabees. It is this religious sense of the term that allows for the phenomenon of conversion to Judaism, which is reflected in the fantastic claim in 2 Maccabees chapter 9 that Antiochus Epiphanes, on his deathbed, promised to become a Judaios. And it's also exemplified in the forceful conversion of the Idumeans to the Judean way of life under John Hyrcanus, who was the descendant of the Maccabees a generation later. Before that point, wrote Cohen, the word Judaios and its Hebrew and Aramaic equivalents always and everywhere mean Judean and not Jew. Thereafter, Judaism was an ethno-religion, For most Judaioi in antiquity, the ethnic definition was supplemented, not replaced, by the religious definition. Jewishness became an ethno-religious identity. Now, Cohen's proposal has been criticized from both sides. On the one hand, Joseph Blenkinsop finds it difficult to accept that the geographic ethnic connotation gave way to the religious cultural understanding of the term as late as the Hasmonean period, and that it was only at that time that Judaism began to accept proselytes. There were, after all, foreigners who joined themselves to the Lord in the period of the Restoration, that is to say, back about 500 BC. In Blenkinsop's view, this transition had already taken place in the Persian period. On the other hand, Steve Mason from Toronto denies that there was any fundamental shift in the Hasmonean period or at any time before late antiquity. Mason argues that there was no category of Judaism in the Greco-Roman world, no religion either, and that the Judaioi were understood until late antiquity as an ethnic group comparable to other ethnic groups with their distinctive laws, traditions, and customs, and God. They were indeed Judeans. Conversion entailed a decisive shift from one ethnos to another. Mason translates Judaioi as Judeans by analogy with other ethnic groups in antiquity, Romans or Idumeans. What we might regard as religious observances were integral to ethnic identity. Implicit in this discussion are distinct views of what it meant to be a Judaios. Mason's insistence on translating the term as Judean bespeaks a view that Judean identity is primarily determined by ancestral place of origin. Those who prefer to translate by the term Jew see rather a way of life to which people can subscribe regardless of their ethnic origin. Whether the terms Judean and Jew can bear the weight of this distinction may be questioned. Denny Schwartz, who teaches at Hebrew University, points out that the English word Jew entails descent as well as religion, in effect agreeing with Cohen that the word refers to an ethno-religion. He also agrees with Cohen that Judaioi in the Hasmonean and Roman period could be defined by religion as well as by place and descent, notably in the case of conversion. Nonetheless, he retains the distinction, which he reformulates in terms of the question whether the Judaioi of whom we are speaking understood themselves more as residents of a country or as adherents of a religion. So he argues, Judaioi in 1st Maccabees should be translated as Judeans, while in 2nd Maccabees, according to Schwartz, the same term is more appropriately rendered as Jews. On Mason's understanding too, ethnicity entailed traditional cultic practices and beliefs about gods. His objection to the word Jew in the context of antiquity is that he takes it to refer to a religion in the modern sense of the term, as a privatized area of life that can be bracketed off from the rest of society. Indeed, on this view, there was no religion in this sense in antiquity at all. Neither Cohen nor Schwartz shares this restrictive understanding of the word Jew or of religion. Mason's insistence on referring to Judeans is helpful insofar as it defamiliarizes our understanding of the people in question, but the issue is not just a matter of terminology. The question is whether Judaism was ever conceived simply as a cult in antiquity, or whether Jewish identity could ever be formulated in terms that did not involve law and common descent, or converse land and common descent, I mean, or conversely, whether it could be formulated as a way of life that was not necessarily tied to ancestral origin. Now, in order to put this debate in perspective, it may be helpful to reflect a little on the category of ethnicity. While this term only appeared in the English language in the 1950s, the word from which it is derived, ethnos, goes back to Homer. In Greek, it can be used to refer to a number of people or animals who share some cultural or biological characteristics and who live and act in concert. Homer uses it variously in reference to a people, the Lycians, to companions, and even to bees and birds. The term is most often used for groups to which other people belong. the Septuagintal use of ta ethne for the Gentiles, or the Goyim, is typical in this regard. In popular perception, ethnicity is often bound up with a common homeland and common ancestry. It is difficult to distinguish between ethnicity and nationality. I follow the view that nationalist identity involves an aspiration to political autonomy. So in the recent case of the Scottish election, you could make a nice distinction between ethnicity and nationalism. That nationalism becomes a factor in Judean identity beginning with the Maccabean revolt, but that is for another occasion. Judaioi take their name from the province of Judah or Judea, which in turn is named for the putative common ancestor, Judah. Josephus, the historian who wrote at the end of the first century of the Common Era, says that they have been called by that name from the time when they went up from Babylon. People for whom ethnic identity is important generally accept the common homeland and ancestry as factual givens. This is known as the primordialist position. The classic formulation of this view of ethnicity was by Clifford Geertz. By a primordial attachment is meant one that stems from the givens, or more precisely, as culture is inevitably involved in such matters, the assumed givens of social existence. Immediate contiguity and kin connection mainly, but beyond them, the givenness that stems from being born into a particular religious community, speaking a particular language, or even a dialect of that language, and following particular social practices. These congruities of blood, speech, custom, and so on are seen to have an ineffable and at times overpowering coerciveness of themselves. In the words of the classicist Jonathan Hall, put briefly, the primordialists consider ethnicity, along with religion, race, and territory, to be a basic and natural unit of history and humanity. Ethnicity is merely an extension of kinship and the normal vehicle through which common goals might be pursued. The modern study of ethnicity, however, has generally rejected primordialism and denied that ethnic groups are determined by blood and land and other primordial factors. Rather, it emphasizes the malleability of community identity, the role of discourse in shaping it. Ethnic groups like nations are imagined communities, in the phrase of Benedict Anderson. There's an old European joke that a nation is a group of people united by a common error about their ancestry and a common dislike for their neighbors. Frederick Barth famously argued that it is the ethnic boundary that defines the group, not the cultural stuff that it encloses. Groups are identified by the things that differentiate them from their neighbors, and these may change over time. Barth made a valuable point that culture and ethnic identity are not coterminous. Most of the cultural matter that at any time is associated with the human population is not constrained by this ethnic boundary. It can vary, be learned, and change without any critical relation to the boundary maintenance of the ethnic group. Some cultural features or practices are assigned higher symbolic and diagnostic value than others, and these may vary over time, as they serve to distinguish an ethnic group from its neighbors. This general approach to ethnicity is variously called constructivist, subjectivist, or even instrumentalist. A properly instrumentalist approach holds that some interest group exploits part of their traditional culture in order to articulate informal organizational functions that are used in the struggle of these groups for power. The instrumental manipulation of ethnic symbols is undoubtedly a fact of history, and it will concern us again, notably in the case of Ezra. But ethnic symbols cannot be conjured out of thin air. Abner Cohen, a leading instrumentalist theorist, also notes that culture is not the sum total of the strategies adopted by independent individuals. Norms and beliefs and values are effective only because they are collective representations of a group that are backed by the pressure of that group. And as the biblical scholar Carly Crouch puts it, the development of an ethnic identity is based in and draws power from a group's historical and cultural roots. In other words, there's a little truth on both sides of that argument. I think there's a pretty strong consensus nowadays that, you know, ethnic identity is never as given as a primordialist would have you believe. But at the same time, it's never entirely invented on the occasion either. Most anthropologists, while granting the importance of boundary issues, still feel that the cultural stuff is important in understanding ethnicity. Hutchinson and Smith list six features that ethnic groups habitually exhibit, albeit in varying degrees. A common proper name, a myth rather than fact of common ancestry, shared memories of a common past, one or more elements of common culture, normally including religion, customs, or language, a link with a homeland, or in the case of diasporas, a symbolic attachment to an ancestral land, and a sense of solidarity on the part of at least some sections of the group. They comment, this brings out the importance of shared myths and memories in the definition of ethnies and the subjective identification of individuals with the community. Without the shared myths and memories, including myths of origin and election, then the sense of solidarity we engender, we would be speaking of an ethnic category rather than a community. And similarly, Jonathan Hall argues, the connection with a specific territory and the common myth of descent remain distinctive characteristics of ethnic groups, even if one does not subscribe to the primordialist position. Mason, writing with an eye to the Greek use of ethnos, also emphasizes the importance of common traditions. Each ethnos had its distinctive nature or character, expressing unique ancestral traditions, which typically reflected a shared, if fictive, ancestry. Each had its charter, stories, customs, norms, conventions, mores, laws, and political arrangements or constitution. He goes on to add that an ancient ethnos normally had a national cult involving priests, temples, and animal sacrifice. This cannot be isolated from the ethnos itself, since temples, priesthood, and cultic practices were part and parcel of a people's founding stories, traditions, and civic structures. Already in Herodotus' Book 8, the Athenians reassure the Spartans of their common Greekness. We are all one in blood and one in language, who those shrines of the gods belong to us all in common, the sacrifices in common, and there are our habits bred of a common upbringing. Mason adds, however, that cult and ethnos may be distinguished for our purposes, partly because there was no one-for-one match between a people and a single cultic system, but the Judean ethnos was an exception in that regard. Even Josephus, writing after the destruction of Jerusalem, was concerned to defend the antiquity of our Judean race, the purity of the original stock, and the manner in which it established itself in the country which we occupy today. His treatise Against Appian is largely concerned to refute hostile accounts of Judean origins, but also includes a lengthy exposition of the laws and ways of life, including the temple cult, which was no longer functioning when the treatise was written. John Barclay comments that Josephus does not weaken the significance of descent or territory in Judean identity, and that the term Judaios has not become an indicator merely of religion, but retains its connection with kinship and even land. Accordingly, he opts for the translation Judean. But he also notes that Josephus use of the constitutional model allows for an expansion of the definition of ethnicity, and that the apparent close tie between ancestry and culture is loosened by the acknowledgement of people from other nations who adopt Jewish laws. Purity is a matter not only of ancestry, but also of law observance. In short, what we call religion was embedded in the whole web of ethnic identity, but it was an essential component of that identity. To say that Judaism did not exist as a non-embedded religion is not to say that Judaism, as the distinctive way of life of the Judean people, did not exist at all. Hartley's reference to the constitutional model is made in the introduction to his commentary on Josephus' tractate against Antioch. Josephus develops this model of the Judean way of life in the second book of the treatise in his rejoinder to the critiques of Apollonius Molon and Lysimachus. He undertakes to give an account of the whole structure of our constitution and its individual parts. Berkeley introduces his summary of this account as follows. Here, Moses is presented as the original legislator, nomothetes, whose constitution embraces all features of the Judean life, from their religious rites to their social behavior, from their domestic customs to their stance against foreigners. The political category makes Judeans comparable to other peoples, especially within the Greek tradition. The legislator Moses can be favorably compared with Lycurgus or Solon. The constitution which establishes the singularity of our lifestyle, according to Josephus, is in effect the law or Torah of Moses. This is the ancestral law of the Judeans, and it can also be called our ancestral philosophy. It is possible for foreigners, especially Greeks, to come over to our laws. Affinity, says Josephus, is not a matter of birth alone, but also of choice in lifestyle. A similar claim has been made for Greek culture by Isocrates in the 4th century BCE, when he said those who are called Hellenes are those who share our culture rather than a common biological inheritance. In his classic study of conversion, published in 1933, Arthur Darby Nock distinguished between two kinds of religion in the ancient Mediterranean world. The first kind was linked to particular ethnic groups. The second, which he dubbed prophetic, was a matter of individual choice and included Judaism, Christianity, the Greek philosophical schools, and cults such as those of Isis and Mithras. Nock distinguished between Judaism and Christianity as he realized that Judaism in practice remained predominantly the religion of a particular people. He drew attention, however, to a phenomenon in the Hellenistic Roman world that was not confined to Judaism or Christianity, but was related to the social and political changes brought on first by the spread of Hellenism and then by the Roman Empire. Common descent and shared history are still important for Josephus and for Judeans in general, but he also allows for an elective approach that views Judaism as a philosophy or way of life. In fact, the view of Judaism as a philosophy is found already in the mid-2nd century BCE in the Jewish philosopher Aristotle, who wrote, "All philosophers argue that it is necessary to hold devout convictions about God, something which our school prescribes particularly well." By our school, he meant Judaism. The ethnic dimension of this philosophy is not thereby eliminated. Judaism remained an ethno-religion, but the perception of a comprehensive way of life, whether conceived as law or as philosophy, that was not necessarily dependent on blood and descent, represents a significant development in the understanding of Jewish ethnicity in the Hellenistic age. The idea that the ethnicity of local peoples found expression in their ancestral laws, or patrioi nomoi, is characteristic of the Hellenistic world. It was the ancestral law of the Judeans that Epiphanes proscribed in his decree. The concept of ancestral laws or ancestral constitution or customs was derived from classical Greece. Thucydides reports that in Samos, the oligarchy was deposed because they had done wrong in abolishing the patrioi nomoi. When Andocides was on trial for impiety, he cited an earlier decree of Tisamenos, which stated that the Athenians shall conduct their affairs in accordance with the ancestral customs. Ancestral laws usually meant laws hitherto in effect, and they provided the framework for political action. Beginning with Herodotus, Greek ethnography expressed a respectful interest in the laws and customs of other peoples as well. First thing that a Greek ethnographer did when he was trying to study another people was figure out what are their ancestral laws. And if you're a civilized people, you had better have ancestral laws. Josephus claims that Alexander the Great visited Jerusalem, and that when the high priest asked whether they might observe the ancestral laws and in the seventh year be exempt from tribute, he granted all this. The whole narrative is highly legendary. It is unlikely that Alexander ever went to Jerusalem in person. As Eric Gruen has put it, Alexander's visit to Jerusalem is outright fabrication. But the idea that the conquering king would affirm the right of the conquered city to observe its ancestral laws is quintessentially Hellenistic. Elias Bickerman demonstrated that the first favor bestowed by a Hellenistic king on a conquered city, and the basis of all other favors, was the re-establishment of the municipal statutes. In virtue of the conquest, the subjugated city was no longer entitled to its institutions and laws, and it regained these only by means of an act promulgated by its new master. There are plentiful examples. When Philip V of Macedon gained control of the island of Nisiros in 201 BCE, he proclaimed to the inhabitants that the king has re-established among us the use of the ancestral laws which are currently in force. You might think that if they were currently in force, he wouldn't need to re-establish them, but he did, because he had to put his stamp on them. When Antiochus III, that is the father of Antiochus Epiphanes, conquered Jerusalem in 198 BCE, he issued a proclamation that all who belong to the people are to be governed in accordance with their ancestral laws. The proclamation assumed that such laws already existed. Already at the beginning of the Hellenistic age, Hecataeus of Abdera had written about Moses as the lawgiver of Judea. Hecataeus seems to have had information of uneven quality. Judea, he wrote, had been settled by people who had been aliens in Egypt, but were driven out. Moses, the head of the colony, founded Jerusalem among other cities and built the temple there. So, you know, he got some of it right. Then Moses organized the 12 tribes and regulated matters of worship. Hecataeus added a famous comment: the sacrifices that he established differ from those of other nations, as does their way of living. For as a result of their own expulsion from Egypt, he introduced an unsocial and intolerant mode of life. Despite that judgment, the account is actually quite positive, and the tone is that of a neutral observer. For our purposes, the significant point is that Jerusalem and Judea were believed to have ancestral laws derived from Moses as early as 300 BCE. Some of you listening to this may think, what's the big deal about that? The big deal about that is that there has been a movement, especially in European biblical scholarship, to down-date almost everything in the Hebrew Bible and to dispute the historicity of the law before the Hellenistic period. Now, I think here you at least have a pig. I'm not suggesting that it was just invented at the time of Hecataeus, but at least it was well established by the time of Hecataeus. It was these ancestral laws that were at issue in the Maccabean crisis of the 2nd century BCE. The ancestral way of life that had been acknowledged and even enjoined by Antiochus III came under attack a generation later during the reign of his son, Antiochus IV, Epiphanes. The attack came in two phases. The first was initiated by Judeans. First, Maccabees refers to them as lawless men who persuaded many, saying, "Let us go and make a treaty with the nations around us, because ever since we separated from them, many evils have come upon us." First, Maccabees mentions only two of the measures they took. They built a gymnasium and undid the marks of their circumcision. And these, as you may well know, were related that it was because the marks of their circumcision would have been visible in the gymnasium that they wanted to undo them. Second Maccabees, now from the viewpoint of First Maccabees, both of these were boundary markers that distinguished Judeans from Gentiles. Second Maccabees develops this episode in greater detail. It identifies the protagonist as Jason, brother of Onias, who promised to increase the tribute and pay an additional sum besides, if he might be given permission to set up a gymnasium and a nephed beum, that is an institution for training young men, and to register the Jerusalemites as Antiochians. When the king assented, he set himself to convert his countrymen to the Greek way of life. He set aside the established royal laws favorable to the Judeans that had been obtained through John, the father of Eupolemus. He broke down the lawful constitution, this is all Second Maccabees, and introduced new customs contrary to the law. Second Maccabees also dwells on the gymnasium and its disruptive effect on the temple cult. Where he complains the priests were no longer interested in staying on the altar to offer sacrifices, but were rushing off to compete with the javelin, and that they loved to wear the Greek hat. The Greek hat seems to have been a kind of sombrero that people wore to give themselves some shelter from the sun when they didn't have any other shelter. The enthusiasts for the gymnasium valued as nothing the customs of their fathers and coveted only Greek honors as worthy of attainment, says Second Maccabees. Both First and Second Maccabees depict Jason's reform as an attempt to overthrow the ancestral laws and change the Judean way of life, so that it was no longer distinctive among the peoples of the region. Second Maccabees describes the adoption of the new way of life as Hellenismos, exemplified in enthusiasm for the gymnasium and the Greek hat. It also introduces for the first time the corresponding term, Judaismos. Judas Maccabee and his followers strove zealously on behalf of Judaismos. He admitted into his army those who had remained into Judaismo. The elder Rassis, who meets a gruesome death in 2 Maccabees 14, had been accused of Judaismos in his youth and had risked body and soul on its behalf. Now, Steve Mason argues vigorously that these terms should not be translated Hellenism and Judaism. Rather, he says they refer to activities, the promotion of Greek and Judaic ways respectively. Judas sought people who had persisted in the Judaizing program, not simply remaining Judaioi, but striving to bring back other Judeans and reinstate the ancestral laws. Mason consequently cautions against adopting the word as if it were generally understood to mean the entire culture, legal system, and religion of the Judeans. It is not then Judaism as a way of life, he writes, but a newly coined countermeasure against Hellenismos. But even if we grant the active connotation of these words, and I'm not sure we should, they can hardly be emptied of cultural content. Hellenismos still implies a concept of an entire culture that was being advocated. And conversely, Judaismos is not simply agitation, even anti-Hellenistic agitation, but the advancement of the ancestral way of life of the Judeans. In the words of Daniel Boyarin, it refers to the entire complex of loyalties and practices that mark off the peoples of Israel. Whether or not we should accept that Judaismos has the static sense of Judaism in 2 Maccabees, it implies a clear understanding of a well-defined Judean way of life. As Lenny Schwartz has argued, Judaism in 2 Maccabees seems to mean what it means for us, something which one can practice, to which one can remain devoted, something to which a wicked king might forbid people to declare allegiance, but to which some, especially in villages outside the king's supervision, might nonetheless remain loyal. There is no reason to turn it into doing something to others. Judas Maccabee, however, did not take up arms against Jason's reform. The question arises how far Jason actually repudiated the ancestral laws. the erection of the gymnasium and the pursuit of physical exercise were not forbidden in the Torah, you may be interested to know, although they were alien to its spirit. The most direct violation of the Torah mentioned in either Book of Maccabees concerns the attempt to undo circumcision, mentioned in 1 Maccabees 1:15. Literally, they made themselves foreskins. Since circumcision had long been regarded as a symbol of the covenant, in effect as a boundary marker, and that, I think, goes back to the fact that the Philistines didn't circumcise themselves, although the Egyptians did. This action could reasonably be interpreted as a repudiation of Judean identity. This would be in accordance with the wish attributed to the reformers to undo the separation from the Gentiles. But it should be noted that at least in the first century of the Common Era, it was possible for a Jew to argue that one could serve God without circumcision. And I am not thinking here of St. Paul, but of the story of the conversion of the royal house of Adiabene. 2 Maccabees acknowledges that some of the Hellenizers were reluctant to participate in the cult of pagan deities. When Jason sent a delegation to the games at Tyre with 3,000 silver drachmas for the sacrifice to Heracles, the delegates diverted the money to fitting out ships. And so what I'm suggesting there is that people who undid their circumcision didn't necessarily mean to throw the whole thing over. It may have been a matter of disputing what are the essential boundary markers. It is clear that Jason wanted to reform the Judean way of life. It is not so clear that he wanted to repudiate it completely, as the books of Maccabees imply. The changes in the sphere of religion and culture seem to have been limited to the gymnasium and related activities. There is no indication that Jason interfered with the traditional festivals or the temple cult. As Cherikova noted, the reform was political and cultural, not specifically religious, in the sense that it did not involve any conspicuous change in the temple cult. Eric Gruen concludes that 2 Maccabees has vastly overrated a crisis that few at the time seem to have found particularly alarming. That too may be a little bit of an overstatement, but at the same time, he has a point. There is also no evidence that Jason compelled anyone to participate in the activities in the gymnasium. Danny Schwartz argues plausibly that it is doubtful that all Jerusalemites were forced to become citizens of the new city and to participate in its institutions. Those who wanted to go on observing the ancestral ways were certainly allowed to do so. The reorganization may have had the effect of marginalizing traditional observance, but it lacked the element of compulsion that would have provoked resistance. Those who flocked to the gymnasium presumably still thought of themselves as Judaioi and did not entirely repudiate the traditional way of life. Neither is there any evidence that Menelaus initially sought to change the nature of the temple cult. Only after civil war broke out between Jason and Menelaus during Epiphanes' second invasion of Egypt did the situation change. As 2 Maccabees tells us, when news of what happened reached the king, he took it to mean that Judea was in revolt, so raging inwardly, he left Egypt and took the city by storm. And then after that, he sent in the Athenian elder to compel the Jews to forsake the laws of their fathers and cease to live by the laws of God. As Robert Doran in his commentary on 2 Maccabees has shown, 2 Maccabees provides a coherent account that is plausible in the Seleucid context. Thinking the city was in revolt, Antiochus IV took it by storm and abrogated the gift of allowing the city to live by its ancestral laws, as his father had done formerly to Apollonia at Bindakos. Instead, he imposed new laws that included cultic celebration of the king's birthday, sacrifices to Zeus, and processions in honor of Dionysus. The account of 2 Maccabees sheds light not only on the new observances introduced by Epiphanes, but also on the understanding of ancestral law in Judea in the early 2nd century BCE. Doran summarizes, the ancestral laws abrogated included circumcision, Sabbath observance, and kosher regulations. It appears that these were attacked not because Antiochus IV was persecuting the Jewish religion, but because circumcision affected citizenship, Sabbath observance affected the civic economy, and kosher regulations affected cultic meals. But one might better argue, I think, that these practices were singled out because of their symbolic value as boundary markers of Judean ethnicity. For the same reason, it was forbidden to have copies of the Torah, which was the iconic representation of the Judean way of life. These were the practices most widely associated with Judaism. What Antiochus wanted to break down was the ancestral laws and way of life of Judea, and thereby the distinctive identity of the rebellious people. In addition to practices like circumcision and Sabbath observance, the king also struck at the temple cult, the most prominent public expression of the Judean way of life, both by forbidding the traditional offerings and requiring sacrifices to foreign gods. His attention to the cult was the counterpart of the decree of his father, Antiochus III, who made special provision for the cult when he affirmed the ancestral laws. The decrees of Antiochus differed from the reforms of Jason in two crucial respects. First, they involved compulsion and the use of force. Second, they suspended the traditional festivals and imposed a new form of cult. According to 2 Maccabees 6:9, these decrees were also enforced in the neighboring Greek cities, but there is no indication that Antiochus systematically pursued Judeans throughout his empire. His actions were a local punishment for perceived rebellion, but they did constitute an attempt to erase the traditional Jewish way of life in Judea and perhaps in the surrounding areas. The fact that these actions, unlike the reforms of Jason, sparked rebellion gives us some indication of what the rebels regarded as essential to their identity. Not all elements in the ethnic repertoire were weighted equally. The distinctive identity of the people of Judea was not seriously threatened by the introduction of the gymnasium or by the Greek language, but it was seriously threatened by the disruption of the traditional cult. This is even more obvious in the Book of Daniel, which barely acknowledges Jason's reform, but attaches pivotal importance to the desecration of the temple by the abomination that makes desolate. The books of Maccabees see continuity between the reforms of Jason and the decrees of Antiochus. Both were calculated to change the identity of the people of Judea by making them more like the surrounding nations. Bickerman and Hengel even thought that the decrees of Antiochus were suggested by Menelaus as a means of completing the transformation of Jerusalem into a Hellenistic polis. There is some support for this view in the sources. 2 Maccabees 13 has the Seleucid general Lysias tell Antiochus V that Menelaus was the cause of all the trouble. Josephus elaborates by persuading the king's father to compel the Jews to abandon their father's cultic observance. The great majority of the sources, however, Jewish and pagan, place the ultimate responsibility with the king. But whether Menelaus was to blame or not, the royal decrees mark a serious escalation of the assault on the ancestral laws. Jason undermined the status of those laws by changing the constitution of Jerusalem, but he does not seem to have been intent on violating them, and it is not clear that he replaced them with a new constitution of Jerusalem, as was later done by Jerome the Athenian. Antiochus Epiphanes wanted to put an end to the distinctive Judean way of life, and that was quite a different matter. First and Second Maccabees differ in manifold ways in their accounts of the crisis. The family of Mattathias had a central role in First Maccabees. In Second Maccabees, the deaths of the martyrs play the crucial role in achieving the salvation of the people. As Denny Schwartz has argued, 2 Maccabees seems more religious in its attention to sin and atonement, miracles and apparitions, and the like. But the two books seem quite in agreement on the centrality of the law. First Maccabees is greatly concerned with the territory of the land of Israel, and also with the seed of the Maccabean family. It makes no reference to the Jews of the diaspora. Yet its rallying cry was the defense of the ancestral laws. First Maccabees has Mattathias cry out, "Let everyone who is zealous for the law and supports the covenant come out with me." The Maccabees were not necessarily bound by the letter of the law. They famously made an exception for fighting on the Sabbath. If we do as our brethren have done and refuse to fight with the Gentiles for our lives and our ordinances, they will quickly destroy us from the earth. Yet they attempted not only to defend, but to impose the Jewish way of life within the territory that they controlled. According to 1 Maccabees, they struck down sinners in their anger and lawless men in their wrath. The survivors fled to the Gentiles for safety. And Mattathias and his friends went about and tore down the altars. They forcibly circumcised all the uncircumcised boys that they found within the borders of Israel. They rescued the law out of the hands of the Gentiles and the kings. To be a Judaeus, according to 1 Maccabees, it was not enough to live in the land of Judah, or even to be of the seed of Abraham. One had to observe the law of Moses, at least in its most symbolically significant details. Conversely, while the protagonists of 2 Maccabees are devotees of Judaismos, its story is focused on the city of Jerusalem and its temple. It is doubtful then whether anything is gained by contrasting the Judeans of 1 Maccabees with the Jews of 2 Maccabees. Both books allow for the possibility of conversion, in the case of Antiochus Epiphanes in 2 Maccabees, in the case of those who were forcibly circumcised in 1 Maccabees. Neither defines Jewish identity purely in primordialist terms of land and blood, although 1 Maccabees leans more in that direction than does 2 Maccabees. Both regard life according to the ancestral laws as essential to what it means to be a Judaeus. The advocacy of the law in both books of Maccabees may be viewed as instrumentalist, insofar as it tried to identify what it meant to be a Judaeus with the observance of the Mosaic Torah, and thereby brought the Maccabees to power. But it also appealed to a tradition that was already well established. The terminological debate about the translation of Judaeus, then, is ultimately misleading, insofar as it suggests that a clean distinction can be made between the views of Judaism as an ethnos and as a religion. Cohen is right that Judaism from the Maccabean period on was an ethno-religion. I would argue that it was already that in the Persian period. Once the law or Torah of Moses became accepted as the ancestral law of the Judeans, it is possible to become Jewish or Judean in virtue of observance of that law, regardless of birth or genealogy. Now, there is a certain irony in that. In the larger project, which this is the introduction, I will argue, you know, that the law was given this normative status in the Persian period. According to the Bible, this happens. The person who did this was Ezra, and we don't have any reason, I think, to call him anything else. So let us say it was in the time of Ezra that it was elevated to be recognized by the Persians as well as by the Judeans as the ancestral law. Now, Ezra, I think, was surely a primordialist. He was very concerned with the holy seed. He coined the expression, as far as we can tell, the idea that the ethnic purity was genetically transmitted. But nonetheless, I will argue that by elevating the law as the norm, he made possible an elective view of Judean identity, because he made it possible for people to follow the Judean way of life, even if they weren't ethnically or genetically Jewish, and equally for people to exclude themselves from the Judean way of life, even if they were descended from Jews. It remains true. history was both Cohen and Mason realized that the religious and cultural aspects of Judaism remained embedded in an historical community that was predominantly shaped by ethnic descent and original geographical province. Mason is right to insist on the ethnic character of Judaism, and his use of the translation Judean is a useful reminder of that character. But what we call religion was an important element of an ethnic identity. And as Lee Levine has argued with some justification, there is ample evidence to assume that the religious component among Jews was a far more prominent and salient characteristic than for other contemporary ethnic groups. It was certainly a prominent aspect of the ancestral law of Judea that was attributed to Moses. Different elements of the ethnic repertoire could be emphasized at different times and places. Judaism could even be presented as a philosophy in the Hellenistic diaspora. But even there, the religious and cultural aspect of Judaism was never entirely separated from the ethnic ties of land and blood. This, I would think, has not changed in the modern era. The articulation of the Judean way of life in terms of ancestral laws derived from Moses was arguably the most distinctive development in Second Temple Judaism. It was not an innovation of the Hellenistic period. Its roots must be traced at least to the Persian period, maybe even the Neo-Babylonian one. But it was not the only way in which Judean identity could be identified in that period. What I will talk about tomorrow is the persistence of non-Mosaic forms of Judean identity in the Second Temple period. And I will talk about those in three moments, and there are others. The first one would be at the period of the Restoration. This is before Ezra, but also including the Judeans, so-called by themselves, who lived in Elephantina in the south of Egypt, and who don't seem to have had a copy of the Law of Moses at all. Secondly, the early wisdom tradition as found in Proverbs, Job, and Kohelet. Although that is disputed by some people, it still seems to me to attach no normative importance to the Law of Moses. And my third example is the more recently controversial one of the tradition associated with Enoch. Now, there is some evidence that the Enoch tradition begins to accept the authority of the Mosaic law in the Maccabean period, but we still find other books of Enoch, in the similitudes of Enoch, second Enoch even, that persist down into the Christian era and ignore Moses completely. So that will be my topic for tomorrow.
Professor Collins is willing to entertain a few questions.
Just speak loudly. Actually, you know, this is supposed to be the introduction to a book that will probably have 9 chapters. And the last one will be on Paul. Now, since I am an Old Testament scholar, I am a little uncomfortable writing on Paul. But fortunately, and providentially, I am married to a New Testament scholar. And so I will coerce her into writing the chapter on Paul. But now, the agenda that I'm trying to set up is that Paul is on the spectrum of Jewish opinion. Daniel Boyarin called Paul a radical Jew, and I think that is precisely right. There would be other radical Jews in history later on who were not disowned by Judaism to quite the same degree. But I think, that he goes farther than any of the Judean authors that I'm willing to write about. But at the same time, you can see that he is part of a debate. And some of the other chapters that come in between, will concern, there are two big moments, it seems to me, in the formation of Judean identity. First is Ezra. And I think Ezra realized that it was advantageous for the people of Judah to have an ancestral law that the Persians would recognize. Now, whether it was Ezra himself who did this, or parties unknown, we don't know. But in any case, a law book was cobbled together. And those of us who occasionally work on the Pentateuch are endlessly fascinated by its internal contradictions. but it was cobbled together, and it stood. Now, when Ezra brought that back to Jerusalem, he didn't expect people to read the whole thing. He just wanted to tell them that according to this law, you have to observe these festivals. And now, the book of Ezra doesn't actually talk about circumcision. That doesn't seem to have been a problem. The Sabbath, yes, that's a big issue. And marrying foreigners is a no-no. But there are a number of key provisions like that. And apart from that, I think people went their merry way. Down until the Maccabean Revolt, when again a party tried to push the limits, this is what I've just been talking about. In the reaction to that, the Maccabees ran on the platform of the law. And it's after the Maccabean Revolt that you get the rise of the Pharisees and the Essenes and people who want to examine every jot and tittle of it, and the rise of what we call halakha. That is intensive legal exegesis. Very little of that. There was some of it, but very little before the Maccabean Revolt. But when that happens, then does that mean everybody is going to agree? Hell no. In fact, this is what intensifies division. Because then people have different interpretations. And then people have to justify their different interpretations. One of the ways of doing that you get in the Dead Sea Scrolls is by appealing to a higher revelation. To an apocalyptic revelation. It's an element of that in Paul too. In the diaspora, on the other hand, they do not go the halakhic route. They weren't as affected by the whole upheaval of the Maccabean period, and they regard the whole thing more as wisdom, which is the way also some people had regarded it before the Maccabees. Now that, I think, is the other ingredient in Paul. But you can see, that you can push the limits both by the appeal to the higher revelation and by the appeal to general human wisdom. But Paul is going to push that then, farther than anyone had pushed it before, I think. So I hope the last chapter of the work will agree with my views on that.
Yes. Would you include Paul among these non-Mosaic streams?
Not really, no, because I think Paul is starting from the assumption that, Paul isn't coming from a tradition of non-Mosaic Judaism. I think he is somebody who starts out with Mosaic Judaism and rejects it. And that, I think, is probably unique. There's a very interesting parallel to my mind of the book of 4th Ezra, where I think Ezra in that book also starts out with a very Deuteronomic understanding of the law and finds that it doesn't work. But he doesn't repudiate. He just says, in addition to the 24 books of the Torah, you have to have 70 other books. Which we now call the Apocrypha and Pseudepigrapha. yes, sir.
I'm a little intrigued. I don't want to spoil your lecture tomorrow, but you've just emphasized that the Maccabean period emphasized the Mosaic law, which is part of the ethnographic background, partly for nationalistic reasons. But then you've just finished telling us that a little later you have divisions among the Sadducees, the Pharisees, and the Essenes. Mm-hmm. Well, what happened to that nationalism that was appealed to in the Maccabean period? Because surely during the Roman period, there would have been a lot of nationalism as well. So why did this this Mosaic tradition, which had been strengthened by the Maccabean period, suddenly come under sort of more scrutiny?
Well, you know, I mean, it came under more scrutiny, first of all, because people attached heightened importance to it. I think the reaction of the Pietists, these would be the predecessors of the Pharisees and the Essenes.
The Sadducees.
Not so much the Sadducees, actually, but them too. You know, their reaction to the whole upheaval of the Maccabean period was to say that, look, they've been trying to get rid of this law. This is our identity. We must live it in all its details. Right. Now, so it's then when the Maccabees expand up into Galilee, that is when you begin to get these mikvaot, the purification pools, and the stone vessels for purity, which people now see, you know, as signs of a new rigorous observance. Now, the Pharisees and the Essenes hated each other, but they agreed on the importance of the Torah. Right. And, you know, even the Essenes were not kicked out of Judaism, so to speak. You know, nobody said they weren't Jews. It's really only after the fall of Jerusalem, after the collapse of any Jewish political control, that then you get sects really going their separate way, Christianity being the most obvious example.
Right, there's another thing I'm curious though, and that is, since the Pharisees seem to represent the majority, as far as we know, why wasn't there objection to the Maccabeans while this was going on? Or were they all sort of subsumed by nationalistic feeling?
When the Maccabees came to power, the issue was whose interpretation of the law would be considered authoritative. Now, in the first quarter of the first century BC, it was the Sadducees. And the Pharisees fought against the Maccabees incessantly, to the point of supporting a foreign king. Because when push came to shove, their interpretation of the law was more important to the Maccabees than the national independence of Judea. But after his death, on his deathbed, he said to his widow, "Make peace with the Pharisees, it isn't worth it." And so she did, according to Josephus, and for as long as she was queen, the Pharisees had the power. Now, I think that's the point at which the Essenes decided they had better get out of Jerusalem. But they only went as far as Qumran and a few other places.
Thank you. Yeah.
Yes?
I'd just like to make a comment. This is far more, as you presented, it's far more complex than I'd ever realized, the whole question.
Good. That's what we try to do, you see, is confuse people.
Well, so I'm interested to find out what you're going to say next time about the Torah.
Good.
Thank you.
Yes.
I have a question about the Pharisees particularly. In the European context, I had heard a interpretation that the Pharisees were people who had been in the diaspora in Babylon, and that had returned during the Hasmonean times. And one of the reasons why they sort of had a more rigorous approach to the law was because they had been separated from the temple compound for already 500 years or 400 years from the time of the original exile. And I'd never read it anywhere, but it was, you know, it was actually a whole school of French biblical scholars who had brought that up, and I thought it was interesting, but I have no source for that.
You know, there is at least one famous Pharisee rabbi who is said to have come from Babylon, but it's certainly not the case that all of them did. I think that, you know, this was a homegrown movement. You will get the same argument about the Essenes. Some people have argued that they had come back from Babylon.
And I'm just interested in sort of the diaspora of how much the identity of the Judaioi in the diaspora, then coming back, how much that would have influenced the Hasmonean. Because I imagine that in the Hasmonean time, when you had the Jewish independence, or the Judaioi independence for a while, there would have been heightened nationalism and wanting to go back to.
Yes, that there certainly was. You know, I don't think the input from returning exiles was a significant factor in it. There probably was some of that, but I don't think it was a significant factor. Also, when you're speaking about the diaspora, you have to distinguish between East and West.
Well, yeah, but I'm thinking of...
You know, of the Eastern diaspora, that is where you might well get... But we actually don't know very much about the Eastern diaspora at all.
Alexandria
was a whole different kettle of fish.
Yeah. May I? Perhaps this could be the last question.
I'm just sort of wondering about Hellenism as a sort of ethnic. You sort of have this pan-Hellenism that sort of created, you know, everyone's sort of learning Greek culture and stuff to a degree, yet there's still many ethnoids within that. So would you still have a Judaism? Would there should be Judeans if they had sort of gone over more to a Hellenistic, synchronist sort of situation and rejected the ancestral laws, but they still be Jews or just a different time?
Well, you know, that's one of the great imponderables.
Yeah, exactly.
Elias Pickerman, who was one of the great historians of this, concluded his book, The God of the Maccabees, saying that but for the Maccabees, the light of monotheism would have gone out. We have no Judaism, no Christianity, no Western culture. He himself was an utterly secular Jew, didn't care a hoot actually for the details of the law of Moses, but he was still a Jew. So, you know, we just don't know.
Yeah.
It is true that there were an awful lot of small nationalities like the Edomites and the Moabites that disappeared from history. And surely the law was a big factor in that. But in the end of the day, we don't know.
The last thing that I want to do is to end this conversation. But the next thing that I would like to do is to move it downstairs and share a glass of wine, as well as to continue this conversation. So please come downstairs with us and have a bite to eat and a glass of wine. But first of all, please join me in thanking Professor Collins.